Could you divulge a bit your own story in the making of some of these devices or tools or customization that we now find in your book?
Well, let me take the maker mix, which is an idea that comes from blowing up false dichotomies. You know, there's a bunch of them, you know, and then you get stuck. Like, well, work-life balance. Well, if I have more work, I have less life. You know, if I have more life, it's like, what's a mediocre balance? That's terrible. So there's a lot of false dichotomies. And one of them that my students present a lot of times is, hey, you know, I could go get this, I can make this, get this job. I can work for a big consulting firm and make a lot of money. Or I could take this job, you know, as a teacher and be do something really meaningful. But I can't seem to have both. I can't have money and meaning. And we just think that's not true. And whenever we see a false dichotomy, we try to blow it up and fix it. So we came up with this idea that everybody's a maker and you're just getting paid in different currencies. So the maker mix isn't just two things, it's three. In the market economy, we get paid in money. If you're working in the social economy, nonprofits and NGOs, you get paid in impact. How many kids are in my after school program and they're learning to read? And if you're in the creative economy, you get paid in expression. You know, I got to read my poem, I got to sing my song, I got to, you know, play my play. So when you look at it that way, you realize, oh, there's more going on here than just money versus meaning. And there's lots of ways to get, you know, paid, get psychic reward for what you do. And once you do that, you blow up the false dichotomy, and now the result is freedom. Now I can see how to design a life that has a little bit of everything in it. And it's like a mixing board. We use the example of when you're mixing a song, if you're a sound engineer, you're mixing a song, you don't shove all the dials to the top. That would be a horrible sounding song. You know, all the treble, all the bass, all the vocal at 100%. It's a mix, and different times in your life, you need a different mix. And so that seems to be helpful for people, that because it reframes a dilemma that you can't get out of, and it opens up the space for new solutions. So that's the one I like. Dave?
You mentioned MAP, so, you know, we like acronyms, or I like acronyms. You know, we're from Silicon Valley. It's a rule you have to use three-letter acronyms on a regular basis. So MVP, minimum viable product, is a very common thing in the venture space these days, because you don't want to over-design something. You want to get the market feedback and go get some revenue. Don't overdo it. Our agent helped us design the minimum viable book, you know, and MAP is minimum actionable problem. You know, and a complement to that is the BDO, not the BTO. The best doable option, not the best theoretical option. It's in choice making. What should I do? And the BDO, BTO, with that acronym, you know, really comes out of an early career struggle for me. So I finally did find my passion while I was in college. The OPEC oil crisis landed, back in the 70s. And I went, oh, that's it. I'll solve the energy crisis. So I came out of college with a passion to solve the energy crisis. And in fact, I had a master's in thermosciences. I was a designated Stanford Research Advanced Energy Fellow, paid for by Chevron Research. You know, I had a sticker, literally, that said, I'm an advanced energy person. Now, nobody put in the brochure that there was no advanced energy industry. It didn't exist. It was a great idea. So I came out and just banged my head against concrete for 4 years, getting absolutely nothing done whatsoever, when a long series of events that I won't bore you with turns into Apple Computer calling and saying, would you want to be on actually the original Lisa team? You know, the prior technology to Macintosh, which is where I became the world's first mouse product manager. And I really wanted to be this energy guy. And that wasn't happening at all. And I had no interest in computing whatsoever and no background in it. It was really strange. And Steve Jobs literally says, hey, come work with us. And I'm looking at, well, they're trying to change the way computers interact with human beings all over the planet, which wasn't an idea I had, but it's actually happening. And this is an idea I love and nobody's there. What would I rather do? I think I'd rather do something than want to do something. Maybe I could adopt their interest and I could work my way, act my way, design my way into a passion for something that's actually moving. And that turned out, that's why I fell through an open manhole cover into high tech, which worked out pretty well. But nonetheless, the whole idea of, I often say design has a ruthless commitment to reality. That none of the design steps work anyplace other than in the here and now in a place called reality. And doability is a prerequisite to taking action. So we're trying to help people find what they can do.